Welcome, everyone, to the St. Pete by Night Twitch channel, where we play St. Petersburg by Night, a massive multiplayer 5th edition game set in the World of Darkness, including Vampire the Masquerade, including Hunter the Reckoning, and including Werewolf the Apocalypse, and, if the rumors are to be believed, hopefully within the next year or so, Mage the Ascension as well. That's where my bets are. But who knows, in the World of Darkness, things are very, very unpredictable, so we can never be sure what they've got in store for us. My name is Kent, also known as Misha Kent on all social media. I am the lead storyteller of St. Pete by Night and the host of After Dark, which is our very, very special behind-the-scenes look at St. Pete by Night, at the World of Darkness, at TTRPGing in general. We talk to the players, we talk to the storytellers, we talk to the movers and shakers of the World of Darkness and of St. Pete by Night to get a better glimpse at the game, at the setting, at the experience of those players and individuals involved with the game. That being said, tonight we have a very, very special topic we are talking about. We've talked about it quite a bit over the last several weeks, and this is going to be kind of the last time we really get into it until next year. Of course, we are talking about Kindred Con 2. As you can see here, we had some amazing individuals come all the way down to St. Petersburg, Florida to get together, have a nice little meetup, and celebrate St. Pete by Night and Vampire the Masquerade and the World of Darkness as a whole. And it was quite an event to behold. And tonight I have some of those individuals joining me who were at that particular event. Let's give them a moment to introduce themselves. Kyrie, why don't we kick it off with you, then Lakar, then Leisha, then Tyler. Take it away, though. Introduce yourself.
Yeah, sure. I'm Kyrie. I play Gray Novak on the server, who is a Toreador who aspires to greatness. Question is if he'll ever achieve it or not. And honestly, I thought that the KCON was awesome. It was amazing meeting everybody and actually being there in person and, you know, seeing some of these people that I've spent so much time with face to face.
Wonderful. We'll get more into all of the details, the nitty-gritties, the good, bad, and ugly of Kindred Con. But Lakar, take it away. Introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Lakar, Lakar the Artificer. I play Matthew Halden, a Toreador on the server, an artiste in more ways than one.
And we'll get into how there might be a little bit of a blending between Lakar and Matthew Halden in just a little bit when we talk about our trip to the Dalí Museum, but we'll get back to that. Leisha, go ahead and say hello and introduce yourself.
I'm Leisha, the Leisha May. I play Delilah Deacon, a member of the ministry, kind of posing as a Toreador. this was my first Kindred Con.
Yes, and I'm very excited to hear how you thought it went. We had the privilege and the pleasure of talking to Leisha as our lead up to Kindred Con, and so I'm interested to follow up with you to see if the experience lived up to the hype and if you actually did enjoy yourself, as this was a huge first trip for you. But again, we'll get back into that very, very, very shortly. Tyler, say hello.
Hi, I'm Tyler. I'm a storyteller on St. Pete by Night, a little bit Bruja, but Toreador at heart.
Now, this particular After Dark is very, very special because we are having a major, major giveaway. So we had all of these wonderful, wonderful prizes come in to be given away at Kindred Con. But because of the low turnout, we kept a few of those prizes away from Kindred Con so that we could give them away here on After Dark. And tonight's prize is a set of dice from Ember Fox Dice. Allie, one of our moderators on St. Pete by Night, also known as Fox, put these together special for Kindred Con. And just look at those dice. They are unbelievable. Absolutely gorgeous. They could be used for Vampire. They could be used for Werewolf. They could be used for Hunter. They could really be used for any World of Darkness game, and I definitely want to encourage all of you to go check out our sponsor, Ember Fox Dice, over at foxdice.bigcartel.com. So go check them out, give them support, put in your custom order, because I could tell you, she makes incredible dice. I got to hold them in my very hands, and I wanted to keep them close to me, my precious, not to be given away to anyone, but I know what the purpose of these dice were, and I have to make sure they get into the hands of one of the amazing, amazing viewers tonight. So, in order to enter the giveaway for those dice, which will be announced at the end of the evening, you can enter by going to the chat and using the hashtag DiceMePlease. That's DiceMePLZ, and you can be entered into the running, and I will draw the winner at the end of the broadcast, and then I'll be getting in touch with that particular winner to get their shipping information so I can ship them straight from Florida into the awaiting hands of the individual who will be so lucky as to have this amazing, gorgeous, beautiful set of dice, which I will probably attempt to steal back from them at a later date. But that being said, let's talk about KindredCon. KindredCon, for those who don't know, was an event that took place on January 19th through the 21st. Although, based off of the time some of these individuals spent in town, it was more like a two-week span of time spent in Florida. And being a resident of Florida, I didn't appreciate the way the weather was behaving. But it seemed for everyone in the frozen white north, it was a nice break from the sub-zero negative early or low teen temperatures that all of you were experiencing. So let's just ask as a whole, generally, to start things off, what did you think about KindredCon? Now we've got two individuals. This was your first time in Kairi and Leisha, and we have two returning guests in Lakar and Tyler. So I've expected kind of a variety of answers here, but Kairi, just kind of give me your overall synopsis. You did a little bit in the introduction, but talk to me about how you felt KindredCon went as a whole as it was advertised to the actual experience.
Yeah, I had a great time. And in fact, you don't have to be coming from the frozen north in order to be experiencing those freezing temperatures. We left from Dallas and it was freezing here, and the temperature in Florida was wonderful. I think the only thing that kind of got on my nerves a little bit in regards to the weather was that it got even better after we left. So obviously we should have just stayed longer.
Obviously next year you're going to have to extend that trip or potentially consider making the move, but I'm not going to push that on everybody as much as I normally do. Lakar, this being your second trip to KindredCon, how do you felt like the trip overall went?
The trip was spectacular because, like Kairi, I left from a very cold place and came to a not so cold place. But like, I came from Ohio and it was like 14 or 17 degrees when we left, and it was a lot nicer here and I really didn't want to leave. But then, yeah, once we left, it got nicer and it picked up once we left or once we got back, but I would have preferred to stay down there. We are talking about moving at some point in time.
That's definitely one of the things that we're considering for scheduling next year, because the last 2 years, for some reason, there's always been a cold snap, like just before or the week before. So you're kind of getting the leftovers of that cold snap. And so we're thinking about pushing it back a weekend, even though it won't fall on the anniversary, to potentially catch that warm up that has happened both years. To my dismay, after everyone has left, we get the warm weather for a weekend. So, yeah, that is something we're considering going forward. But I'm glad that it was at least a defrost for you. Being Michigan native myself, I can say I totally empathize with those Ohio temperatures. It is the worst. Leisha, your first KindredCon. This is the question I have been on the edge of my seat to ask you. You were very excited, but also very anxious because this was your first time traveling out of your home state. This was your first time getting on a long airplane trip. This was your first time kind of taking a jump into the deep end of travel. Did KindredCon live up to your expectations? Did you enjoy yourself?
It sucked. Okay. No, I'm kidding. It was incredible. It far exceeded my expectations. The whole thing was a little bit surreal in the beginning. Like I got off the plane and I'm in the airport and I'm like, where do I even go? Like I had to message Kent and be like, how do I find you? Because he was picking me up.
Yeah.
And like, yeah.
Yeah, it's I love the Tampa airport personally. It is my favorite airport in the entire country for a variety of reasons, but it's huge. And if you don't know, you have to get on a monorail. You can find yourself wandering down one of the terminals, just being like, how do I get out of here? And then not knowing what to expect on the other side of the monorail. Yeah, it could be an entire experience unto itself. Tyler, you definitely take home the trophy as the one who stayed the longest in Florida, without a doubt. What did you think about this year's kind of KindredCon experience overall?
It was great. I got there a little bit earlier than most people and definitely left a lot later than most people. It was cold and windy the last 2 days that I left, like really windy. 19 miles an hour of the wind. I was thinking of going to flying a kite at the beach or something, but I feel like I took the weather with me back to Southern California, where now it's overcast and rainy, but I did have a good Saturday when it was 80 degrees on the beach.
Well, feel free to take more of that weather, because we're still in like the low 60s here, sometimes 40s at night, so I'll be happy to shove that away and get back to the 70s that I love so much. Okay, so everybody has a story about how travel went, you know, how their travel experience was, but no story is as interesting to me or intriguing to me as Kyrie's story of getting to KindredCon, because there seemed to have been a little bit of a delay, is putting it mildly, for your arrival. Why don't you kind of take us through that?
Sure. So there's two airports in Dallas. One is DFW, which most everybody knows, and one is Love Field, which is much smaller. And apparently, when I was booking tickets, I didn't realize that I had booked through Love. So we showed up at DFW ready to go, and lo and behold, no one can find our reservation. So I pull it up and I'm looking at it and I see the four letters LOVE right next to the airport, and they get bigger and they get bigger and they get bigger, and it just hits me like a ton of bricks, and I'm like, we're at the wrong airport. So end up racing over from DFW to Love Field to try to get there in time. We spoiler alert, we do not get there in time. We totally miss our flight. And then we get it rescheduled. We end up, you know what, like, you're going to get there as soon as possible. So we're going to take the red eye out there. In the meantime, make all sorts of other changes so that we can make sure that we can stay an extra day, because we didn't want to lose the day of being out there. And then we arrive only to find out that, our hotel canceled on us because we were no shows. A whole rigmarole happens after that. End up working with the hotel in order to get a room, and you know, they were very good. They were very kind to us. They gave us a suite and they made sure that we were taken care of. But yeah, it was a little bit crazy getting there. And then we had less crazier time getting home, but it was still crazy time.
Yeah, and I recall too that the hotel actually worked with you really well to get your arrangements kind of all figured out, and it actually ended up working out for the better in the long term. So that was nice that it didn't end up being too much of an issue once you were finally here, that was all able to get straightened out. And it seemed, at least based off of initial impressions, that everything after that was just enjoyable for the majority of the time.
Oh, absolutely. Everything afterwards was awesome. The only headaches were getting there. And honestly, those were all my fault. I think it's the first time in my entire life that I have ever missed a flight. And I'm never doing that again. That's never happening again.
Yeah. So public service announcement to those of you watching at home. If you have two airports near you, make sure to triple check the tickets the night before planning your route to another airport. But I was so Glad that you were able to make it. You and Nori both were able to make it. That was one of the highlights of KindredCon for me. And I mean, seeing everybody is a highlight, but I was really, really excited to meet the two of you in person for the first time, and that you were able to rearrange it. Because when the news came through that you weren't getting on the plane, I was a little scared, a little devastated. And I was like, they have to be here. So I'm glad that that all worked out. Lakar, any interesting travel stories from your time coming down?
We flew into Atlanta, and Atlanta is confusing. And trying to find anything in that place when their tech wasn't working was bad enough. But all in all, it was a pretty... they had to force us on the plane to leave because I didn't want to go home. I wanted to stay, and it was too nice. But I don't think anything can top Kyrie's story, no matter how bad my stories would be. Nothing will ever top that. So even if I did have an interesting one, there would be no point in saying it.
It's a pretty killer story. It is a pretty killer story. Now, Leisha, this was your first big plane ride. Like, I think if I recall correctly, you've taken like maybe a 90-minute flight before, but it wasn't that far. It was just kind of like a quick flight. But this was like big time, because both you and Tyler, for those who don't know, come from the west side of the country all the way down to the southeast. And that can be one hell of a plane ride, especially for a first time plane ride. Kind of take us through what you were feeling, you know, going to the airport, packing, getting on the plane. Like, what was that whole experience like for you as kind of like a first time major traveler?
Well, I left my house at 5 a.m. Pacific time to get to the shuttle, to go to the airport, to get to my flight. And everybody had been prepping me with all of these horror stories about missing flights and like trying to get through security and all these horrible things. And it kind of like, I'm sitting on the bus on the way to the airport, and I'm like, no matter what happens, I'm gonna make it there. I'm gonna get there. Like, I'm prepared for anything. And it honestly, there was one tiny hiccup, and it was just that going through DFW, they switched our gate like 15 minutes before we were supposed to board. So we had to run across the airport. But that was the only hiccup. And like, as I'm going through everything, like going through security and finding my gate and everything, I'm like, am I cheating? Like, this is going so smoothly that am I doing this correctly? Because it went so smoothly that it was just kind of like, okay, well, I guess I'm just getting on this plane now. And I get off the plane and I walk to the new gate. And I'm like, okay, I'm getting on this plane now. Like, it was probably the easiest travel experience I've ever had. Like, I've flown once before, and it was maybe an hour long. It was on like a 50 person seater plane. But other than that, I've done only like long car trips and just up and down the West Coast,
right?
Primarily. And this was easier than that. So I was like, I feel like I'm cheating. Beginner's luck, maybe.
Thankfully, they've had 20-something years now to figure out how they want to do heightened security and everything. So thankfully, in my experience with recent travel, it has been a lot smoother than it ever has been in the past 2 decades. And so I'm really glad for your first experience. You got to see everything kind of work smoothly and work out for you. Do you have any fear of flying, or was this kind of just like the... anxiety, the usual anxiety and kind of excitement about going somewhere new?
It was mostly excitement. The only anxiety I had was because of the weather. I was worried that things were going to get delayed, or I wouldn't make connecting flights. Because when I left my house, it was 17 degrees outside, which is abnormal here. It usually doesn't get lower than the 30s Fahrenheit in the winter. And so my roommate was supposed to take me to the airport, and instead, because he's lived in Texas for a long time, and so he was like, I can't drive in this. because there was snow and ice on the roads, and I was like, well, can you drive me like 6 blocks to the shuttle? So he was like, I think so. And we made it. But it, yeah, no, it was mostly just like I'm on my way and I'm ready. And why have I waited 31 years to do this?
Absolutely. And for those who are unaware, the week before, about a week before, give or take, the event itself was when the major ice and snowstorms were kind of sweeping their way across. And we were seeing like record lows, worst snowstorm of the year, if not several years, for most of the country. And so a lot of people had concerns about travel. I know flights were being canceled, flights were being delayed. And me being the primary pickup person for a lot of people at the airport, I was having to keep a really, really close eye on that. But I was happy to see that your flights didn't really seem to have any issues, thankfully. Now, Tyler, you also coming from the West Coast, you come from kind of warmer temperatures, to put it mildly. And so what was your travel experience like? Any interesting stories from that?
Well, I wasn't too worried about the weather because it was, you know, 58 degrees here and 58 degrees there, pretty much the same. I did have something interesting where my plane almost landed in Dallas-Fort Worth and then took off and took a steep ascent, you know, back into the air. I don't know what happened, if there was someone on that runway or something got mixed up or if they just wanted to try again, but they had to wait their turn another 15, 20 minutes and we finally landed. But that was enough to make me have to jog to my gate. I was about to get Starbucks and I looked at my phone and I said, oh, boarding is like leaving now, not boarding now, because yeah. I got an alert. So I hurried up and I was basically there already. So I was one of the last 5 people to get on the plane, but I had my seat reserved. So that ended up fine. On the way back, no real problems. They confiscated my peanut butter, but that's about it. I bought too many supplies and I figured I could bring this on. It's not a liquid, right? But
well, as someone who's had to run and has missed his fair share of connecting flights, my advice to any inexperienced travelers out there is to give yourself at least an hour, if not 90 minutes in between connecting flights. That seems like a lot longer of a time than it actually is. But keeping in mind that boarding starts about 30 minutes before the departure time, that gives you at least a good 30 minutes from your arrival before you get to the gate. But yeah, I know that was a concern for several people that their connectors were kind of like cutting it really, really close there. And so yeah, I'm glad. Yeah.
That's good advice because my flight was delayed 15 minutes. And then with that mix up in the landing, it was delayed another 15, 20 minutes. So that gave me 20 minutes to get over to my gate.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And some of these airports too, you don't know if you're going to be running all the way across the terminal or if it's going to be the gate next to the one you arrive next to, especially with the amount of times they've switched gates and everything like that. But
oh
yeah, go ahead.
And at the monorail, I came up with a new character idea. I saw this guy and he looked pretty cool. He had like a slick, sharp tweed suit, not tweed, but like that color, beige, 85-year-old Marine. He had like a knapsack that you saw. It was like from the Marine Corps.
Right.
And he was just flying with like a small tiny bag and he looked like a business Marine. So I'm like some kind of Ventru character.
Some Ventru business Marine.
Yeah, because I landed at like midnight or 1 a.m.
So my question to the group, and we'll go one by one for answers again, is this your first time traveling into this area of Florida? If not Florida entirely, obviously, Leisha, it is for you. But what were your kind of first impressions coming off the plane, kind of coming into the Florida environment, especially now that you have this kind of new lens of St. Pete by Night and Tampa and kind of all these things, all this time you've spent in the environment? What was it like driving across the bridges, you know, to Pinellas County? What was it like, you know, seeing it all for yourself now that you have this experience of having had to visualize it and having had to experience it, you know, kind of in your imagination? What was all that like? Kyrie, we'll start with you.
Yeah. So many, many, many years ago, I actually lived in Florida with my parents. And as I'm coming across the bridge, I'm getting flashbacks to hearing my my mother talking to my father about, there's no way, if there's just water on both sides, if there's a wreck, we're just gonna go right over the edge. Like, she used to be absolutely paranoid when it came to driving over those bridges. And it was, I was just hearing that and driving over the bridge and thinking at the same time, like, Mom, this ain't as bad as you made it out to be. Like, it's a nice open highway. It's not, there's not a problem here. It's beautiful looking. It's absolutely gorgeous. And I didn't feel the same anxiety that I remember her having. So,
well, that's good. Lakar, now this is your second trip, obviously. So you kind of had some preconceived notions, but talking about your first trip and this trip, kind of what is that experience like for you coming into Florida, coming into the stomping grounds of your characters and of where you've spent a good chunk in your imagination, at least over the past 2 years, being a part of? What's that like for you when you see it for yourself physically?
When I first got the first last year when we got here, it was very surreal. Like, I'm in the middle of, there is no water anywhere in the vicinity of me that doesn't come out of a tap. So to land in a place like Florida where you can spin in a circle and you're going to see water in large bodies and quantities of it, it was very, oh, this is the ocean. I mean, when we got married, we took a cruise from, I think, Miami and or Fort Lauderdale. And so when I was on that boat, literally, you couldn't go anywhere because it was nothing but ocean. So when we got down here, I was a little used to it at that point, but it was still very surreal. And then we stayed on, I think, Madeira Beach last year.
Yeah, last
and
year.
It was like away from everything. It was just water and beach. And this year we were more in the, we were in the city. We were literally smack dab in the middle of the city. And it was just nice to be able to walk around. And I mean, I took pictures. I was taking pictures of the corners of edges and things because I just, it was actually good to be able to get down there and actually walk around for once. Because last year it was like a half an hour trip there and back. So it, we'd stay down there, we'd hang out for a little while and then we'd leave again. But actually being able to sit down there and actually wander the city and look around and get a feel for things. I was somewhat familiar with the path on how to get to places from last year, but by the time I left this time, I was like mastering it. I knew exactly which, you know, which roads could cut down. There was a lot of construction though, so it was like I had to reroute, but it was fantastic actually being able to go there and look at things and kind of have kind of like the face to the name thing, where you actually, you heard about it in the game, but then you didn't actually have a good look about it. And then you saw it and you go, oh, I understand now.
Yeah, and that you had some of the most boots on the ground experience, like really physical on the ground, walking around, kind of observing, especially the downtown area and the territories as we'd mark them out in the game. We'll talk about that more in a second, but I'm very interested to hear more about kind of your walking tour and walking around experience, because you didn't rent a car. You pretty much hoofed it to most everywhere. Of the things. Yeah. And that's incredible. But Leisha, how much of a, would you say it was like a culture shock coming from, you know, what you know to be familiar to something like Lakar said, that is surrounded by water and is, you know, obviously different temperatures, especially for this time of year. What was it like for you arriving into Florida for the first time, having been a part of this game for about a year now?
Yeah, so my first thought was like, oh, it's not as glamorous as I pictured it. I was like, oh, it's just like home, but warm.
That's like, fair. That's fair.
I live not far from Portland, Oregon. And I live not far from the Oregon coast. Like, I'm kind of central. You can get to everything within an hour or two driving. And so a lot of it was like, okay, like the houses are slightly different shaped. Like the roofs are a lot flatter because you don't have to worry about water sitting on them. And like the plant life is different. The wildlife is different. There's lizards everywhere. Every time I saw a lizard, I freaked out, like with excitement. I was like, oh my God, it's a lizard.
I remember one of my first trips. Wild. Yeah, one of my first trips to Florida, I had a gecko counter. Even though I didn't know at the time they were anoles and that there was a whole variety of types of different things. I had a gecko counter, and I think I got up to like 60-something within just a couple of days on the trip because they were everywhere. And just like you, it was a complete shock to me, like just so unexpected. Yeah. And now I'm just like, geckos are everywhere. Like I take it for granted.
Saw two squirrels the whole time I was there. But I saw... yeah, dozens upon dozens of the little anoles. And I was like, taking pictures of them because I'm like, ooh, this one's darker. Has just the silliest little things. But it was very much like, the people are just like home, but it was like being home with everything slightly off kilter, like out in the planter boxes outside of businesses, there's snake plants, and where I live, those are indoor only house plants because otherwise they'll die.
absolutely.
So seeing all of these, like in my mind, tropical or house plants just everywhere, I'm like, this is incredible.
Very cool. Now, Tyler, also being your second time, kind of reflect on your first time and this time as well. What was it like kind of arriving in the area and really getting boots on the ground and seeing everything for the first time, you know, especially with this lens, like I said, of St. Pete and St. Pete by Night kind of in your mind?
Right. Arriving was different. I always want to rent a car. It gives me a little bit of anxiety because I'm like, oh, am I going to get a ticket? I parked and some of that stuff from back home. But I need the freedom to go kind of wherever I want, whenever I want. And it was cool. I got to drive around the streets, which are really wide. I forget what streets, like Patricia Avenue, which is one of the streets my character is near. And then I forget. And there was another street like that kind of went to your house. They're just like really wide, not even highways, but just huge streets. I got a Tesla this time, which was kind of annoying. It kind of didn't do what I wanted it to do and did what it wanted, as opposed to SUV. But the downtown area is always really great. It's good to be a Toreador player downtown, because if you're looking at the map that we have on St. Pete of all the businesses and the domains, that one is really interesting. So I know these guys down here have a coterie and their domain is right there downtown. Which is next to my hotel, my character's hotel. We went to visit it at the last couple days, and one of the waiters or one of the staff was like, can I help you? Because I think I was going towards an area that I wasn't supposed to. I'm thinking like, do you know who you're talking to?
Do you know who I am?
It was really cool just seeing the different things, the little cafes and stuff. And knowing where cool stuff to do based on last time was really nifty, because we got a group of people together at a cafe and more people showed up. So we're like, where do we go to get drinks? And last time we have people that need walking aids and stuff. So I'm like, I know where to get. Let's go across the street to this bar instead of something that's far away. Right. So it was good to know the locations. And I saw one of those squirrels too, and it came inches from me and wanted to see if I had any food.
Yeah, the animals here are very domesticated. I think because of the kind of intense amount of population crammed into what is a smaller landmass, relatively speaking, most of the animals here get very, very friendly, and I'll put that in quotes, friendly, with the people. The seagulls on the beaches are fearless, and that's simply put. But yeah. Absolutely. So one of the things that surprises me, even still to this day, as someone who lives here, is how big it can seem when it's actually a rather small landmass. Like from coast to coast, it's maybe 15, 20 miles at some of the more wide points, but it can take you 45 minutes to an hour, you know, just to get from one coast to the other, sometimes even longer, depending on the time of day. And so I think that it's very interesting seeing the kind of compacted population in this small landmass and how that can affect travel. Did you find anything, all of you, did you find anything surprising or unexpected about the area, or something that maybe you hadn't quite pictured just looking at it from, you know, maps and from hearing about it in the game. Was there anything that was really a big surprise to you when you actually visited firsthand? Kairi, we'll start with you.
Yeah, there wasn't anything that was actually too surprising, although I was very pleasantly surprised, I should say, surprising, whatever, with the bar that Tyler had talked about, and then another one that we had gone to, and there was all of the craft brewery stuff in the area was awesome. And, you know, coming from Texas, there's a big craft brew scene going on here. And to see that kind of mimic somewhere else where I could then be like, hey, you know, give me something local and get something local was awesome. As far as like the traffic goes, I was actually shocked that the traffic was light compared to what I'm used to. Maybe it was because of the which weekend it was, but I'm not so sure with the boat show going on. But it seemed far more easy to get around in general than it does in Dallas.
Yeah, and it's funny too, because this time of year is when we see our population almost double with all the snowbirds and all the people who come down just for the winter months of the year. I usually think it's more populated and heavier traffic during this time of year than it is in, say, the summer when, you know, everybody's off at their homes up north or vacation homes elsewhere. But yeah, I think that there was something to be said for the timing being, you know, far enough away from the holidays, but a week before Gasparilla, which is a big festival over in Tampa, you know, a week, you know, outside of a lot of the major events that happen in the area. I think it kind of falls at a good time to be coming into town because it's a little bit of a lull before it starts to pick up again, or at least everybody is settled in. Having come here from up north and everything, they found their routines and their rhythms. But yeah, that's interesting that the traffic didn't seem as particularly bad as you might have expected. Lakar, what was kind of like a big surprise for you about, you know, first trip in now or, you know, blended together about coming here versus what you had pictured and what you'd experienced through the game?
Like you were saying, it's a lot different looking at a map than it is when you're actually standing there. And when I was wandering around with Kairi and everybody, like, you know, kind of showing them our area down there, looking at it on a map, it looks, you know, you're like, okay, it's this many blocks by this many blocks, you know, okay. But then you get down there and then you're like, these are some pretty big blocks. Like it's a lot bigger once you're there. Cause you can't really look at the size comparison until you're actually physically present. Like yeah. I was actually off by like a block because I misremembered how the size was. And then I went, wait, oh, okay. Yeah, this is a lot bigger than I thought. And then I was walking the other places and I was taking photos and everything. And I'm like, okay, this area is pretty big too. Like last year when we went to the church.
There we go. Now we're reconnected. Okay, so Leisha, what kind of experiences were shocking to you or surprising to you? I mean, I'm sure there was kind of an overall kind of shock to it all, but what was kind of like surprising in terms of the game or the setting as you had seen it versus the reality you ended up coming upon?
I think for me, the biggest thing was that it's flat. The land is very flat. I live in a valley between two giant mountain ranges. So any time I turn, there's a mountain. I have a picture that I took out of the airplane window where you can see four mountains, like four very distinct mountains in that mountain range as we're leaving. And coming here, I was like, oh, everything's just flat. And so in a way you can see, like you can see more around you because there's not like, there's a hill that like this block's on the hill and that block's not. But it was also like you can't see as much at once because you're not seeing hills full of buildings in the distance. You just see the sky
Yeah, so everything's at very eye level.
Yeah, and that was something that I had never really thought about. Like, so if you're seeing something looming in the distance, it's one of the skyscrapers. It's not an entire neighborhood, like you can see here. And so it makes those buildings a lot more imposing, I think, because they are the thing on the horizon.
Yeah, absolutely.
Rather than seeing the whole city backdrop like you see in my area.
Right. Tyler, how about you? Anything that was surprising to you when you got here versus kind of what you had pictured, and not just this trip, but the first trip as well? Like, was there anything that kind of was a clash to how you had envisioned it while experiencing the game?
Honestly, not really. I think downtown is a little bit more compact, but compared to like the sprawling, it was like Patricia Avenue, Main Street, the big, long, huge ones. There were a lot of grocery stores and a lot of gas stations.
Mm.
So those big, long streets, I guess in LA or Southern California, would be filled with really expensive buildings. But once you get away from the downtown area, there's like a lot of suburbs in the middle. Yeah, shout out to the Ale and the Witch, which is where we went to the bar next to the Dracula wine bar. There was a lot of cool places downtown that I discovered that I hadn't quite gotten to before. Those are the Witch one was moderately priced. The Ale and the Witch was pretty good, but you can definitely find some more expensive areas downtown. I was surprised that Indian Rocks Beach, which is next to Madera, which is on the West Coast, which is almost like a sandbar of an island that just goes up the Gulf of Mexico. The hard part is getting in there. Like, there's bridges. So that bridge is the only way you can get there unless you got a boat.
Yeah, in fact, all of the major beaches from St. Pete Beach all the way up to Clearwater Beach are kind of on this own little sandbar, like you said, that runs along the West Coast. And there are several bridges that connect in the middle, but only at major intersections. Like off of major roads like Ulmerton and stuff like that going all the way up. So if you get over to the sandbar there of the beaches, which is the beaches, basically, you gotta have to find one of these bridges to get across, and it could take you a while north or a while south to find them, depending on where you're positioned. But yeah, that totally makes sense.
But yeah, the drinks over there were $5 happy hour all night, like amazing. Mm-hmm. All the bars in the little, there weren't a lot of them, but the restaurants were really great down there.
Well, and Indian Rocks Beach, too, is a locals beach. Most of the tourists either find themselves at St. Pete Beach or Clearwater Beach. So you are actually in a perfect place. This is where, like, all of the locals of the area go to the beach because you have to pay for parking in Clearwater and everything's overpriced, or you have to, you know, struggle to find parking in St. Pete Beach. So you actually found a really good spot, as did you, Lakar, with Madera, where there are some tourists, but for the most part, you're finding a lot of locals out there. And so it's more locally kind of local fare, locally priced, because they want to keep those people coming back. So that makes sense.
Yeah, I stayed for an extra week and ended up getting some of the Gasparilla stuff out there. It wasn't Tampa, but Uber was surge pricing and wanted $80 to get over there. So I figured out how to use the bus pretty quickly.
yeah, absolutely.
I rent a car, and yeah, it was a really nice area over there. A lot of hotels, and I think we were driving around there earlier, and we're like, oh, look, the chicken church. So
that was another fun surprise. Before we get to our next question, I want to once again mention, if you're tuning in late, we are doing a very, very special dice giveaway tonight from one of our amazing sponsors, Ember Fox Dice. The set of dice you see on screen is the set of dice you will receive if you enter into this giveaway. You can use hashtag DiceMePLZ in the chat, and we will do that giveaway. We'll make that drawing at the end of the night. So if you have not entered into the giveaway yet, use the hashtag DiceMePLEASE, and you can be entered to get in the giveaway and get this amazing set of dice from Ember Fox Dice. Back to the questions. What was, and this is going to be a big one, what was one of your favorite, if not a couple of your favorite moments from this entire event, from this entire experience? Kind of what was something that really stood out to you as a positive, as something that made this all really worthwhile? And obviously there are probably multiple things, but pick one or two, maybe three at most, of your favorite moments from KindredCon as a whole. Kyrie, we'll start with you.
Yeah, honestly, the KindredCon event, that the event Saturday night was awesome. Being able to meet everyone who I've spent time with over the game for about the past year or so, that was amazing. Being able to see people in person was irreplaceable. I would do it again in a heartbeat, regardless of the troubles with traveling and all of it. One of the things that I think surprised at least Crafty and Leisha was watching them do crochet. I know it's a very tiny thing, but I enjoy watching people be very good at things. And the two of them are very, very good at that and very, very quick at it. It was almost mesmerizing watching the two of them work. And then actually that first night when I got in and both Lakar and Truck were downtown, and Nori and I showed up, and the four of us being down there in our domain together, you know, actually able to walk around and experience the place together, irreplaceable experience. I absolutely loved it.
And for those that are unaware, Kyrie, Lakar, Truck, and Nori are all part of one of our coteries, the Bloody Strings Coterie, and I'm happy to announce that in the next 2 or 3 weeks, probably, hopefully, we are going to be starting to air the Bloody Strings story, ran by Bera the Bard, one of our amazing storytellers. So stay tuned to our schedule for that, as that is set to debut hopefully within the next 2 or 3 weeks. And you'll get to see the magnificent adventures of this group. But yeah, to have that moment as a coterie and to be able to, you know, walk your stomping grounds and really be in the midst of it. I mean, I think this is the first time we've had a full coterie at one of our events.
Well, not just full coterie, yeah, but we had a full table as well. We had our storyteller there too.
That's true.
We weren't successful in convincing him to run a game for us. So that's fine. We'll let that pass.
Next year.
Next year. So Lakar, what were some of your favorite moments or moment of this particular trip?
It coming down again, you know, getting to, you know, see you and everybody, you know, that I've seen last year is always fantastic. But yeah, getting to see like Leisha and Kyrie and everybody that hasn't been down there before was just fantastic. And like Kyrie said, having our entire table down there and being able to walk around and be like, yeah, this is ours. That's ours. That's ours. That's ours. No, that's not ours. It's across the street, but don't worry. We'll give it time. It'll be ours later. But yeah, just being able to actually talk to each other instead of, you know, just on cam from, you know, miles away, being able to, you know, interact and converse and actually, you know, joke and tell, you know, jokes and stories and just being present with the person instead of, you know, just looking at a camera and talking to them. And, you know, it's always a fantastic time.
Absolutely. Leisha, how about you? What was kind of some of your favorite moments of this particular trip?
Well, I was there for almost 2 weeks. And I absolutely loved meeting people and getting to see them all, but everybody's already talked about that. So I think besides that, my favorite thing was just all of the like cultural in cultural buildings. Like there's museums everywhere. Like the pier is a big place to hang out, and seeing all of those. I love that kind of stuff because it really highlights what the city thinks is important, and what the people there want to put their time and effort into, and going and seeing all of those really kind of helped me like see what is St. Pete about when it's not about vampires.
Precisely.
Because that's usually the lens I view it through.
Right. Yeah. That there's a lot more to it. It is a very enriching, diverse, but also artistic culture. And like I talked about in the lore video, which if anybody hasn't gone back and watched that, the After Dark lore episode, go check it out on Twitch or on YouTube. That was really what inspired me to make it a Toreador city, to make St. Pete, especially downtown, a Toreador-dominated domain, was the fact that art and culture is a huge, huge part of this city, and that it is kind of very much not what you would expect the Florida experience to be. You know, obviously people have their own kind of idea of what Florida is, and then being able to see a city like St. Pete, which is very, very counterintuitive, aside from the weather, to what you would expect from a Florida experience, that really does stand out. And I'm glad that you were able to kind of take notice of that and see that firsthand, because that was a really, really big inspiration for me in designing this particular setting. So that's very cool. Tyler, how about you? What were some of your favorite moments from this particular trip?
Well, to play off what you just said and hanging out with Kent, I've definitely learned, like, yep, Thin Bloods live there, Ventru live there, Al lives there. those kind of things were really fun to do. I got to fill in a lot of the gaps of things that I didn't know I wanted to see. The Sunken Gardens was great. I missed that last time. We got to see flamingos and lizards and all kinds of plants. I was just driving all around the Anarch territory, because last time I wasn't an Anarch for very long when I showed up. So, you know, going to Dunedin and Palm Harbor and driving around. We also saw, you know, Leisha's Tables domain, and we almost made it to Ian's office, but that was on the other side of the road. Just going and exploring all the plants and the little swamp areas that are just like in the middle of people's neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, I want to see that, but I'm definitely not going into someone's backyard in Florida.
No, you don't want to do that. No, very much a stand your ground state. You do not want to.
It's their backyard, but just in case. But yeah, just and of course we were the Wawa, eating mac and cheese, waiting for the Tesla to charge, and playing Vampire Survivors in the Wawa while it charged was a lot of fun.
I wish we had Wawa here. We don't have anything
Wawa
like that.
Wawa is pretty incredible.
I love this.
It's pretty incredible. I think a lot of people, if anyone makes the trip out to Florida, definitely find a Wawa and experience the food there. You don't think, you know, top of the line fare when you think gas station food, but this is this is very, very good stuff. It's on par with Sheetz, which a lot of people in the north might recognize, or Buc-ee's, which, you know, is making its way into Florida slowly but surely, but it can be talked about in the same conversation, to say the very least.
I don't know. You say it's on par with Buc-ee's. Those are fighting words.
I love me some Buc-ee's too, but it's getting there. Tyler, also go ahead.
Also playing Vampire Rivals with Kyrie and seeing his obscene deck. And there was one more thing. Oh, yeah, the Blackbird coffee place was really good.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there were a lot of kind of highlight visits, locations that people went to throughout the trip. You know, the Saint is a popular hot spot just because it's a very themed location while we're here. Beaches obviously stand out. But one of the most probably prominent buildings in this entire kind of setting that we've created is the Dali Museum, the First Elysium. It has been one of the most visited locations within our setting. And I know a lot of people took their first real trip to the Dali Museum and got to see it for the first time. So I'd like to ask you all, kind of what was it like actually being inside the building, and, you know, what were some things that maybe didn't match with how you visualized it, or what was that whole experience like? And Lakar, I expect you to tell a very, very important story about your trip to the Dali, but we'll get to that when it's your turn. But Kyrie, one, did you get a chance to visit the Dali? And if so, what was that kind of like experience like for you? Having, you know, you were still pretty new to the game when we were doing Dali type stuff. But, you know, what was it like seeing it firsthand for yourself?
Nori and I got to visit the Dali on our last day there. It was actually one of the last things that we did on our way out as we were headed to the airport. And I think we got in at a really good time because we came in like something like 11 a.m. or something like that. And there was like nobody there.
Yeah.
And by the time we were leaving, like everything was filling up. So we had a whole bunch of time there where it was nice and empty, where we got to just walk around and look at stuff. I was struck by the fact that I had the impression that the area underneath the spiral staircase was much larger than it actually was. And so both Nori and I were talking about it. And we're like, you know, like, if you compare this to how it was like in game, we were kind of all standing like shoulder to shoulder practically with the number of people who were there at some points, like, because that area is much smaller. So when the Elysium would kick off and everyone would be under there, that area would have been packed. But then afterwards, traveling, you know, throughout the building, there's so many different rooms and nooks and crannies, and even, you know, little that you could tell were administrative areas, not to mention the video of Dali's life that they have running in the back, which is very cool. But yeah, I can see totally why you picked it as Elysium. It was an amazing experience to go there. I had a whole lot of fun, and I loved looking at all of the paintings. And personally, Dali has always been an artist that I have really enjoyed. And so actually being at the Dali Museum was really good for me too.
Very cool. Lakar? Let's talk about the Dali, my friend, and why you may never be able to visit it again if the right people were listening. Go ahead.
So the first time seeing it, it was not what I expected, because the museums we have here, they're square. They're you know, normal museum shapes. And then you see the Dali and you're like, okay, it makes sense. When you walk into the museum, there's the doors to the entrance. There's the person who takes your money and gives you your little, you know, band so you can go in and have fun. And right behind it is the gift shop. One of the downsides of my entire table being there is Bera, my storyteller, love him dearly. He almost got me arrested. So we're in the gift shop and you walk back and forth. It's an open area. And I'm sitting there and I look up and he goes, oh, I saw a coffee cup that I think would be perfect for you. And I went, oh yeah, really? He goes, oh wait, I forgot I was talking to the art thief. Loudly, in the middle of an art museum. And to which I was like, what? And he realized what he said and he went, I'm gonna go over there and hopefully you don't get arrested. Bye. Thanks. Not the first, and thankfully, hopefully will be the last of the two times I almost got arrested by people from my table.
Yeah.
While I was there at this event.
So what did you think about kind of like the museum? I mean, you said it wasn't exactly what you pictured, but kind of did you kind of get a certain kind of feel from it? Or what were some things that really interested you about it or the whole experience?
What I love the most about it is it's not just Dali. It's primarily Dali. It's Dali Museum. But you go onto one side and it's all Dali 24/7, or as long as they're open. You go to the other side and it's Dali and the Impressionists.
Yeah, that was a special exhibit. They've had other ones too. Yeah.
And it was good to see kind of the diversity of styles that, you know, there are some that are kind of, they kind of, you know, mesh with his, but then they're very, you know, abstract and very contrasting. So it's good to see a person's life throughout, as you can kind of see them grow and get better, or, you know, depending on who they were, get worse in life. But all in all, it is a very fantastic museum to see a person's experience. Like Kyrie had, you know, I would have loved to have been there to, you know, be there when he went there for the first time and see how he experienced it. I'd been there before, but seeing it again, I didn't exactly know where everything was. I'm a little more adept where everything is now, but that's for another completely different reason that I won't say on camera. Anyway, mostly statute of limitations.
Absolutely.
But yeah, it's really good to, you know, be able to go and experience it. And it's always going to be something, you're going to find something new every time, even though you've been there like two or three times in your life.
Absolutely. Alicia, how about you? Seeing the Dali firsthand, as that was kind of your big introduction to the game, was being taking place in the Dali, and you spent a great deal of time in-game in or around the Dali. What was it like kind of actually witnessing and experiencing it?
It was a lot bigger than I'd pictured. I actually really loved seeing how it compared to the descriptions of it. Because parts of it, I was like, oh, this part's huge, that part's small, this part's this. But it was really cool seeing how accurately your descriptions portrayed the feeling of being there. It was a little bit surreal to walk through and be like, oh, this is where this happened. Oh, this is where that happened. Oh, this is where this happened. Like, oh, this is where that character died. And I couldn't help but look at the whole thing also through the eyes of my previous character, Irina. Because she spent so much time there. And it was a huge, huge part of her story. And going through and looking at everything through her eyes. So I feel like I could have enjoyed it more if I didn't do that. Because she does not like Dali.
So that was a kind of common sentiment. Being like,
yeah. Well, and going through and being like, okay, this picture is really cool and I think it's awesome. But Irina would be like, this is trash.
Did you have any particular pieces that really stood out to you or were important to you, either because of the game or because of your own experience? Like for myself, the hallucinogenic Toreador I view through a very, very special light because of Tyler and Charles, who we'll get to in a minute. But that's one that I always look forward to seeing when I go there. Were there any that you saw that were like particularly impactful? Because I know you had said like, I'm afraid I'm going to get stuck staring at a painting. Yeah.
Yeah, that one specifically was also like it almost a visceral reaction looking at it because it did have a bit of an impact on Irina's story because like she's adoptively related to Charles. And so she knew that that was like an important piece, but for her, it triggered the Toreador bane. It was physically uncomfortable for her to look at. And like looking at it was almost uncomfortable for me, but I was like, I need to sit here and take this in.
Yeah.
Kent and I had a really good scene when he was portraying Irina's adoptive sire, Carmine, talking about that painting specifically and her talking about how it made her so uncomfortable and him being like, good, it's supposed to. This is what Toreador are. They are beautiful, but if you look beneath the surface, they're uncomfortable. They're ugly.
Yeah, they're very unnerving. That's mm-hmm. awesome. So Tyler, you really had a tie to Dali, and we talked a little bit about this at your storyteller interview, which is also available on Twitch and YouTube as an After Dark special, so go back and watch that one. But you talked about kind of how you had a connection to the Dali Museum overseas, and then, you know, finding out that this was located here, that kind of became a very important part for Charles. But what was it like for you seeing it for the first time firsthand and kind of really being in the midst of it again with this lens now of how it was such an important location in the game?
Well, this year we had the hallucinogenic Toreador in our Airbnb. So that was really cool to see. I went in the room and I saw a big thing about that, but the size of that is huge. It's like 20 feet tall painting. And, you know, I went to the Dali Museum in Spain, and that was really, my dad's a really big fan. So I became a really big fan when I went with him and showed me around. But yeah, the size of some of the paintings, the ones next to it, Just some of the smaller things. Having been to Spain, I like the Port of Llegat, and I got my Dolly t-shirt that my dad made me. Cadaqués, Spain, which is where we went. Just the little small fishing towns that he painted are really cool. I also have bad vision, so impressionists are really great because I'm like, oh, look, it's what they intended. Like, just looking at those paintings is what I see without my glasses on sometimes. So
that's fair. That's fair.
I was a little bit more used to the museum, seeing the weird shape of it when I started the game. Going there, seeing it, is that window is really big and it's kind of crazy. All blue, and at night and during the day, it's really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a lot to take in, just like a lot of Dali's artwork, whether it's good, bad, or otherwise. It could be very overwhelming to the senses, and I love the way that that is reflected in the architecture, that they really did take the essence of Dali into the architecture itself, to the point that you're up on the balcony and it's kind of unusual. You're looking through the window and it's unusual. The staircase, like, all of it is very, very kind of somewhat uncomfortable and unnerving, but also just fascinating. And that was kind of, again, one of the things that stood out to me about making it in Elysium was unusual it was.
I talked to one of the tour guides and she had a shoe like upside down on her head, like a hat that Dali made for his wife. So I talked to her and she was one of the tour guides there and she was all into it too.
Yeah, absolutely. So anyone who's new to After Dark, we do allow questions from the chat. So if you have any questions about the KindredCon experience for our beautiful panel here, feel free to please submit those in the chat and we'll get to them as we go along. So let's talk about Saturday night. Now, for those who were not present, Saturday night we had our event at the Magic Ballroom, which was the exact same place we had it last year. I love the venue. I love working with them. They've been very generous. And it's a very affordable and kind of centrally located, a little bit more on the north side, fair to go to. But parking, space, everything about it really works out to fit our kind of endeavor. And so I love working with them and I love hosting there. And I plan to for as long as they allow me to into the future. But let's talk about Saturday night. We had a kind of ask me anything Q&A with the storytellers. We had a lovely feast that was prepared by our own Crafty Mirage and Mimic, also known as Rebecca, who really were the big contributors of that and making that happen. We had giveaways. We had, you know, tables for everyone to chat at. There was music playing. Kind of talk about your personal experience with that Saturday night event and kind of what you thought you really enjoyed, and possibly some things that you'd like to see more of, or maybe you'd like to see improved upon in the future. Kyrie, go ahead.
Yeah, I really loved the event, and I really loved the venue. In fact, y'all did a fantastic job setting that up, the decorations. The food was excellent. Big shout out for that. I absolutely enjoyed the storyteller AMA, and the fact that we just got to ask any off-the-wall questions that might pop into our head, and we had all of y'all up there, and you couldn't run, you had to answer the questions. It was great. The only thing I think I would have changed is that I would have done, with a smaller group we had, I would have liked to have some introductions, like, okay, to some of the folks that I hadn't met before. And I was actually pleasantly surprised that there were people that I had not met before. But I would have loved some introductions, some like, you know, I played this character, I played that character, and a little bit of going through everyone's, you know, quick personal experience with what they've done in the game and how much they may or may not have enjoyed particular characters.
Okay. So a little bit more time spotlighting each individual that attends the event and giving them kind of a moment to really truly introduce themselves beyond, you know, what you've come to know about them on the server. Okay, that's a very good suggestion, and actually something we will try to implement going forward, depending on the size of the crowds, because the first year we had like two or three times as many people as we did this year.
Right.
But yeah, absolutely. Okay, good to know.
But that storyteller AMA, you got to do that again, for sure.
We definitely will. That actually went really, really well, and I was surprised at how long it went. You guys just kept coming up with questions to the point that we actually had to cut it off, which was a surprise to me, but that was very enjoyable. Lakar, you can talk about last year's and this year's, since you've kind of got a blend of both experiences.
I really liked last year's and this year's. It was nice to have a more like intimate setting with, you know, less people. I mean, it would have been nice to have more people, but it didn't take away the fact that there was less people. Like Kyrie said, you know, some introductions just in case there were people there that you weren't familiar with, things like that. But I mean, I pretty much knew who everyone was because, you know, I've talked with them for years now. The food, like you said, fantastic, absolutely, you know, Crafty and Mimic, spectacular. The giveaways, the AMA, I kind of walked in the middle of it, so I didn't know where we were, so I was like trying to think of a question, but I'm like, all right, I'm just watching the microphone get passed around, and I'm like, I want to ask a question, but I don't know what I want to ask, so I'll think of something. And then by the time I finally thought of something, it was too late.
That's fair.
But yeah, by too late, I mean, I thought of something to ask when I got home.
So very, very late.
Yeah, very late, very late. But no, the venue, spectacular. It's a nice size. Even with how big it was last year, it's still, we weren't crammed for space. We just, we learned last year with the food thing, because it was way too much food last year, and it was like the perfect amount this time. And it was, you know, everybody got to take some home, and it was, you know, me and Kat smashed on that as soon as we got back to our Airbnb. So, but yeah, all in all, I thought it went great.
Fantastic. Leisha, how about you?
I wasn't sure what to expect going into it. This is the first sort of event like that I'd ever been to. But it was a really great location, really great venue. It was a little more space than we needed with the smaller group this time, but I think the one thing that I would have really liked was, like, even if we didn't do introductions for everyone, just like little name tags or something that was like, hey, this is who I am, these are the characters I've played, kind of thing. Like, because there was people there I hadn't met, but it was characters I'd heard about, so I'm like, oh, like, because I'm a little bit shy, so like, I think like that would have been like a helpful icebreaker for the more shy people to be like, oh, you're blah blah blah, you played so and so, I heard about blah blah blah. Like,
absolutely. Yeah, we had name badges last year, but with the lower attendance this year, I was kind of on the fence about doing it, but I will definitely bring those back again next year for sure, because you're that is a very valid point. It's just, I know everybody so well that I take for granted that my experience doesn't reflect everyone else's experience, because I'm used to talking to all these people individually or in groups or being in their sessions or whatever the case may be. But that's definitely a good suggestion. Well, again,
yeah, next year. And even as one of the moderators, I'm like, okay, I recognize some of this, but like I can't put a name to all the faces. And like some of the characters were like characters that aren't current. So it's like, oh, I know about that previous character, but not this one. So,
yeah, absolutely. Tyler, your turn. Having been to both, kind of what was your experience like on the Saturday night event blended between the 2 years?
Well, there was definitely a lot of things that were the same and different, and a lot of suggestions or not that I don't know if we could pull off each year. Last time there was a lot of people, so there was a lot of independent tables of people playing cards and people doing things in like small groups of five, but that probably wouldn't have worked out this year. I think it was really great, the number of people we had, but that might have subtracted from people getting to talk to each other and the AMA and things like that. Right. It was great seeing Salubri, who was a returning new player. She had played a little bit in the first one, and she is in my group in the second one, but she played one session and she was able to show up. So it was good talking to her. I saw, who else was there? Oh yeah, Hugo was there, played Valerie. So I got to talk to them and that was pretty cool. I saw them at the same as well. No lightsaber fight this time, but there was some kind of play fighting. less drinks, which was good. I don't drink that much, but I helped with the food and setting it up both times. I was happy that people ate this time because so much was going on last time. And the food was ready. I think there needed, and I think sometimes people are shy or they don't want to be the first one to dig in. But this time people were definitely ready to eat once we set everything up. There was a big line and everything tasted great. The food was great last time. The food was great this time. So it really worked out.
I was really happy to see some of our more, I don't want to say like, but some of our more newer players, some that aren't part of the mod team or aren't part of some of the coteries that have been around a while, like Jay, like Salubri, that were able to, that did take a chance on this, having no real solidified connections coming in, that they saw fit to take a chance and kind of dive in into this was very, very cool to see, because one of the things I love most about St. Pete by Night is the sense of community and the fact that it is a very welcoming community and that people do feel comfortable or at least have the confidence to kind of take a leap and come be a part of it made it really, really cool. And it was good to see, you know, a lot of people come for a second year, but also to see so many people try it for the first year. It was a nice blend of both. And that made it very, very special to me to be able to kind of experience it through that lens. I keep using the word lens, but that's the best word I could think of, is just seeing people experience it for the first time, seeing people come back for a second time. And others that, you know, more fringe players actually taking the leap and getting involved was very, very cool. So what is something you would like to see in Kindred Cons to come? Maybe something that you haven't seen at either of the 2 years, for those of you who've been both years, or, you know, for those who had the first time experience, what's something that you would like to see in future Kindred Cons? Maybe whether it's an event or an activity of some sort, or whether it's, you know, just a feature that we could add in to the event as a whole. So, Kairi, we'll start with you.
Yeah, I think this is maybe because our whole, like I said, our whole table was there and our storyteller was there. And I think that maybe if we hadn't sprung it on Barra too late, we could have convinced him to run a game for us and then at the same time kind of put on a show for everybody else who was there. And I think that would be something really cool if we could have like a table that's actually willing to do that. You know, maybe 30 minutes or 15 like a minutes, live little play. Vignettes with each live play with each table that's there. I think that would be really cool.
Okay. All right. I'll keep that in mind, too. We'll make a note of that and potentially do that based off of what we can get in terms of attendance. If we can get another full table in attendance. Absolutely. Lakar, how about you? You've been to both.
Last year when you drove everyone around and you were doing the tour thing, that would be great. I know it, and there being a lot less of us, we wouldn't have to worry about multiple cars. Like, I think it would have been good this year too. It was just like getting everyone together to been able to do that was, you know, kind of, you know, a little rough. Because there were some people that were like, you know, showing up, people couldn't park, you know, it was kind of difficult, but something like that, I think would be really good too. Do that again.
So like another van tour, like we did last year, yeah. Or a walking tour, like we'd done last year as well. Okay. Yeah. We tried to do a walking tour this year and then got shock rained out at the last second. But yeah, no, definitely. I do appreciate and enjoy showing people around the area because the area is so rich with history in its own right. And so many just fascinating, cool things to see. But also it's rich in the story history. You know, people want to know, put a place to their kind of imagination of where certain encounters or events took place. And I think that was one of the best parts about last year was the van tour and everyone being able to see it firsthand and kind of experience how long it might take you to get from one location to another. Whereas in their heads, it can be like, instantaneous. In reality, you're going through, you know, countless intersections and lights and traffic and battling all kinds of things. So being able to put some distance, I know going with you to the Scientology, the Church of Scientology, was a big feature of last year and really taking in the overwhelming
scope of the church,
just everything about that downtown Clearwater area, can be very, very cool to see too. So yeah, that's a very good suggestion. Alicia, how about you?
So I think like this year going, it was very kind of loosey-goosey, everybody just doing their own thing because it was a smaller group. And I think having like some structured time or activities, like, because we had a lot of extra space with the smaller group, like having like set up activities that people could choose to do would be good. Or since we have so much time, it's like, okay, we'll have like for this half hour, we're kind of focusing on this. If you want to do it, if not, hang out over here. Like, or like, so I don't know. Cause like sitting and talking is a lot of fun, but it's also fun to like get together with people and like play games or things like that. So I think building at least a little bit of that into the event itself.
Yeah. So we had more activities and kind of stuff like that last year. And I found that more people were interested in just milling about. And that might have just been because of the size of the amount of people. But we had like a photo booth and with a photographer, and we had a TikTok filming station and all these kinds of things. And so, yeah, that I can try and definitely bring back some of that, as well as some other, you know, activities and whatnot. But yeah, based off of the smaller number this year, it just felt like, well, everybody will, you know, find their own interests and things. But yeah, that's a great suggestion for next year, for
sure.
It
felt a bit like a house party, but at
to venue, a degree, yeah.
It wasn't bad, but it wasn't quite what I was expecting.
Yeah, so. And it definitely good for icebreakers and stuff too. Tyler, you were at both years. Well,
yeah,
what
we
about
had a
you?
Lot of we had a lot of great meetups before, you know, the Dali at the Saint, those all went great. A lot of people said it, you know, it would be cool if we had like a one shot going on where even players from different coteries, whether it's canon or non-canon, if it turns out that we don't blow up this, you know, do something too crazy to the lore, then we can, you know, give little events here. Like I wanted to do a Kindred fight club where I just brought dice and you would take turns rolling for your characters to see who would win in a fight, characters that are already dead and characters that are new. But yeah, little things, I think like 30 minutes at this table to do an RP session, or 30 minutes to do a non-canon event, or 30 minutes to, you know, little things like that would have been cool. Yeah, sometimes it's just the vibe and it doesn't always fit. A lot of people are looking to party or looking to drink or looking to have conversations and things like that. But yeah, little card games or little things, activities would be fun.
Well, and this might come as a surprise to a lot of people, but I'm a bit of a control freak. And so trying to manage everything, you know, can be a lot at times. Because like I know for the first KindredCon, I'd had an idea of a LARP murder mystery for the players where they come as their characters, and there is, and I still have it in the back of my head, I still have it as a possibility in the future, but I'm still thinking about ideas like that. But for those who are part of the community, we are always looking for volunteers to spearhead kind of activities or, you know, things to be done. The more I can take off of my plate as the one who's, you know, bankrolling and managing and has his name attached to everything, the better. So if you are planning attending KindredCons in the future and have a really cool idea, don't be afraid to bring it forward and take the reins on that and make it happen, because it is a lot to manage, and all the help is very, very much appreciated. But yeah, so I absolutely adored this year's KindredCon, the smaller numbers, getting to meet some new people for the first time, being able to enjoy the night, being able to get my Book of Nod deluxe edition box and unpack that at the event was very cool, especially after waiting 2 years for it. And just having the AMA was a super big, big highlight for me. So that being said, is there any other kind of final thoughts about the KindredCon experience that anyone wants to go over before we talk about the blight of KindredCon that happened this year? Kyrie, any other thoughts that you had about the experience?
A couple of them. It was fantastic. Like I said, it was fantastic meeting everyone. I really enjoyed the fact that I got to meet Jake, 'cause I got to play opposite them, like maybe even just a couple weeks before it felt like. And then meeting in person, it was really cool. Big shout out to Crafty, not only for the food, and Mimic, not only for the food, but for the food recommendations that Crafty gave while we were there and the places to visit. There's one of them called the Floridian, which I recommend anybody check out. That place was fantastic. Big shout out to Mimic for coming up with the idea for the cider swap next year. So I don't know how we're going to manage that, but that was an awesome idea. As we're discussing, favorite ciders that night at the Ale and the Witch. To you, Kent, big shout out for putting all this together and getting us all in one place and making it so that we had a space to meet each other and have a great time.
Thank you very much. Lakar.
Most of what Kyrie said was something I was going to say, so I could just reiterate, shout out to Crafty and Mimic for the food. Kent, you always, you don't, you're not a control freak. I don't know where you get that idea from. But you have the perfect place for us, and this has been your baby for the longest time, and I know it has been rough, and I know some of us have not made it easy on you, but we got you, and we know you got us. So, thank to you for everything that you do.
Well, thank you so much. Lisa.
So I think for me, rather than just like the KindredCon event, just the whole experience of going there and everything, I don't want to overstate it, but it felt a little bit life-changing. So to anyone out there that's hasn't really traveled before, or has thought about going to something like this and been like, I don't know if I want to do it, 100% just go for it. Like the worst that's going to happen is you don't like it and then you don't have to do it again. But it was probably the best 2 weeks of my life so far. So just do it.
Wonderful. Tyler.
Yeah, it was just, I don't know what else to say that it hasn't been said already. It's just great seeing some friends that you met doing this whole thing, being part of the staff this time and helping to get things together is always nice. Just hanging out with people that you usually only get to hang out with online and all those things is a very rewarding experience, and I hope I get to do it next year.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So as a what another reminder to everybody watching, we are doing a dice giveaway, and I'm going to be announcing the winner here very shortly. But for those last minute entrants, you can be entered into the giveaway for a set of Ember Fox dice, that exact set you see on screen, by putting in hashtag dice me please. That's dice me PLZ in the chat. Your name will be entered for a giveaway tonight. And I will cover shipping. I will cover everything that has to do with getting those dice into your hands. And obviously, if you don't win, go support our sponsor, Ember Fox Dice. They are an incredible dice maker. Like I said, I got to hold these dice in my hand. They are absolutely amazing. And you could have a set custom of your very own. So get a hold of Ember Fox Dice and support them. And thanks, big, big, big thanks to Allie. And Ember Fox Dice for supporting this game, for supporting this stream, and for being a willing participant in all of this. So, with travel, with gatherings, ever since 2020, and even before that, there has been a kind of phenomenon known as con crud that everybody gets. It's usually some sort of nasal congestion, breathing thing. That we fall victim to when you see people from all over the country coming into a location, especially with the change in climate, the change in, allergens, and everything like that, these things develop. Well, unfortunately, the con crud of KindredCon 2 was COVID-19, and several of us were struck ill with COVID. Now, I know I'm not going to get too political about this, but for those of you who do attend events, for those of you who are thinking about hosting gatherings, this is one of the things to just continue to be on the lookout for. We are always trying to decrease the spread, and thankfully several members of the community made great sacrifices and were very communicative about their experiences with it at this year's con. And we were able to, you know, potentially protect several people by communicating openly about it, by getting tested. But I know I was hit with it. I know Kairi was hit with it. Lakar, I don't believe you were. But I know
I dodged that one.
Yeah, and Leisha and Tyler also both dodged it. But several of us came down with a bit of the COVID that caused flight delays and travel, you know, delays and that kind of stuff. So just as a reminder to everyone, you know, just be safe. Get tested if you're going to go to a big outing before, during, and after. Get yourself tested. You know, if you are vaccinated, you know, don't forget to get your boosters. It's really important that we remember that this is still a very harmful disease, and it's a very sneaky disease. Just because you don't show symptoms doesn't mean you don't have it. Just because, you know, you are not at risk of anything serious happening doesn't mean somebody you encounter isn't at risk. And while everybody has to mind themselves and protect themselves and know the risks of what they're doing, we're all in this together, and it's very, very important to protect yourselves. But I'm happy to say, despite that, it didn't seem to dampen anybody's experience, and we are definitely looking forward to doing it again next year. Thank you so much to these incredible individuals for joining me tonight, for joining me in Florida just a couple of weeks ago. I can't wait till next year to do it all again and to, you know, make it even bigger and better in years to come. I said it at the first KindredCon, and I've said it since. I'm hoping for a KindredCon 10 one day. I'm hoping to keep this community going, despite any changes to the setting, despite any changes to how we, you know, play the game going forward. KindredCon holds a special place in my heart, and it is something that I seek to continue pursuing and making bigger and better and more efficient and safe and healthy in years to come. So now it is time for our dice giveaway for a set of custom dice from Ember Fox Dice, or those dice that you saw in the photo, which are absolutely gorgeous. Our winner tonight is Hugo Boss X8. Jay, congratulations. You won that set of Ember Fox Dice. I will get in contact with you on the Discord, and I will put it all together and get that shipped out to you. I may even drive it to you because I know you are a Florida native, local to me. So I will make sure to get those in your hands in the next couple of weeks. But congratulations to Hugo Boss X8, also known as Jay, for that set of Ember Fox Dice, which I'll show once more just because they're so pretty, and to make all of you who didn't win even more incentivized to go order your own set. You can find Ember Fox Dice at foxdice.bigcartel.com, or if you're on the server, just get in touch with our lovely, amazing, wonderful Allie, also known as Fox on the mod team, who brings that to our sponsorship, and we are so, so grateful for it. But that's it. Go follow these amazing individuals. You'll find their social medias in the credits after we are wrapped up here for tonight. Thank you guys again for joining me. Thank you for joining me at KindredCon. Thank you for joining me on the stream. And here's to many more KindredCons to come. Go follow St. Pete by Night on all the social medias you see at the bottom. And go check out our unbelievable, one-of-a-kind, unique, masterfully created website at stpetebynight.com, where our wizard, Kairi, has performed some insane magic, unbelievable magic, with our threat tracker, with our storyteller pages, with our game pages. We're even going to be hosting the episodes, or you'll be able to go back and watch the old episodes from the website. Go support stpetebynight.com, and I'm hoping, if he's willing, to have Kairi on for a one-on-one conversation about all of that, as well as his vast, vast knowledge about the world of darkness and Vampire the Masquerade and his experiences with St. Pete by Night. But we'll get to that soon. This week on Tuesday, we have Rage Across Tampa, episode 11, where the pack is going to decide what exactly they're going to do next, having brought Eliza Ross back from the brink of Hirano. Where do they go now? They have a lot of threats and a lot of things to consider. They're going to make that decision and start down that path. Also on Thursday, we have Don't Get Caught. That coterie has gotten themselves in a whole heap of trouble, and it seems that there might be a little bit of conflict within the coterie itself. So we're going to continue to see how that plays out. And then next Saturday, another After Dark. Not exactly sure what the topic's going to be, not sure who the guest is going to be, so you're going to have to tune in and find out for yourself here on the Twitch channel next Saturday. But for these lovely guests, I'm Kent, like I said, Misha Kent on all social media, but go follow St. Pete by Night. It's much, much better follow. And we'll see you all next time here on the St. Pete by Night Twitch channel. Have a good evening, everyone.